Welcome to the Voice of Victory, a ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church. Join us for the next 30 minutes as we minister to you from the Word of God.
And His good pleasure is that we be sanctified and that we grow in the knowledge of Jesus Christ, that we become increasingly more spiritual. And then He lays out for us here, He said, beside this, giving all diligence. In other words, we're supposed to apply ourselves. We're supposed to have constant effort. It's our responsibility to do this, to be diligent in this endeavor. He said, this is what I want you to do. This will make you a child pleasing to me. He said, I want you to add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience, godliness. And of course, he even goes on from there. We didn't read this. But, and to godliness, brotherly kindness, and to brotherly kindness, charity. But I want you to look at something here tonight. And I look at these as continuous stepping stones to a greater spirituality in our lives. And if you want to think that patience is a virtue, because you heard that expression somewhere, help yourself. But when I read the text here, it says, besides this, giving all diligence, add to your faith virtue. And then it says, to virtue knowledge, to knowledge temperance, to temperance patience, and to patience godliness. So patience is a separate and distinct thing from virtue. So that really doesn't have anything to do with the message, but just throw it out there. That one's free. And so based upon what the verse does say, it looks to me like, and it goes beyond this, but just to what we've read here, that patience is the final step on the path, or the previous step, or the last step, if you will, to the path to godliness. Seems to indicate to me that you cannot be godly unless you've mastered patience. I could be wrong. I mean, but I'm reading what it says here. He has these things all lined up, and he's saying, add to this, and then add to that, and then when you do this, then this is what you'll be at, and then you'll get this. And so, that's the path that I see here. Many people believe that patience is something that you need to pray for, or plead for, struggle with, when in fact it's something that needs to be practiced in order to ultimately procure it. That's what it says there. He said, add to your faith virtue, and to virtue knowledge, and to knowledge temperance, and to temperance patience, and to patience godliness. So these are things that he wants us to do. The only way to... Haven't you ever noticed that? When we're not patient, and of course, there are many different areas where we could exercise patience, but one place that we see it oftentimes is with children. And you could be at Walmart, and some mother there can have a half a dozen children that are climbing up over things. They're running around. They're playing baseball in the aisles. And the mother is oblivious. You want to kill a kid. You have no patience with this at all. But somehow she's mastered this. She can zone them out completely. How is that? She's had practice. She's had a lot of practice at it. The Bible says in Ecclesiastes 7 and verse number 8, better is the end of a thing than the beginning thereof. And then there's a colon, and it goes on to explain the rest of the verse, and it says, and the patient in spirit is better than the proud in spirit. So, to me, as Solomon talks about, better is the end than the beginning, it sounds to me, and then he talks about patience, initially none of us are going to be all that patient. We want what we want, and we want it now. Especially in the day in which we live, once upon a time, there was the, remember the old practice called window shopping? People used to actually do that. You don't window shop anymore. You let your fingers walk through your plastic and your wallet. You don't have to wait for anything. But there are many examples of patience in the Bible. For instance, Job. In Job 1 and verse 21 and 22, he said, "Naked came I out of my mother's womb, and naked shall I return hither. The Lord gave, and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all this Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly." Why? Well, according to James, James said in James 5:11, "Behold, we count them happy which endure. Ye have heard of the patience of Job, and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy." You heard of the patience of Job? Job just waited on God. Even amidst all of the heartaches and the tragedies that he had in his life. Yet, what's it say there? He still wouldn't sin or curse God foolishly. Remember David? David said in Psalm 40 in verse 1, "I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry." Which tells me that the Lord did not immediately answer him for whatever it was that he was praying for. Right? Because he said, "I waited patiently for the Lord, and he inclined unto me and heard my cry." Which means he must have continually been doing it and said, "You know what? Till the answer comes, I'm going to keep asking him." And eventually he did. Remember in the New Testament, Simeon, in Luke chapter 2 and verse 25 and 26, it says, "And behold, there was a man in Jerusalem whose name was Simeon, and the same man was just and devout, waiting for the consolation of Israel, and the Holy Ghost was upon him. And it was revealed unto him by the Holy Ghost that he should not see death before he had seen the Lord's Christ." You talk about patient. Here's a guy waiting to die. And he has this promise of the Holy Ghost that, "Buddy, you're not going to die till you've seen the Lord's Christ." I wonder what he thought every time he went to Walmart. You know, every time he saw a little kid in the carriage, you know, he probably went up and looked in his face. "Are you him?" Now, by the same token, it's probably a little scary, because you might also be thinking, "As soon as I see him, is this the big one?" Even Paul, the Apostle Paul said in 2 Timothy 3 and verse 10 and 11, "But thou hast fully known my doctrine." In other words, you've known me. And then he lists all kinds of things: manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience, persecutions, afflictions, which came unto me at Antioch, at Iconium, at Lystra. What persecutions I endured, but out of them all the Lord delivered me. So all of those things that came unto him, things that he considered to be persecutions, he said, "You know what I did? I endured them. I endured them." And he developed patience. And so I want to give you several things as it relates to patience tonight. It seems to me that what Peter has laid out for us is the path to patience. The path to patience. You're not going to get patience by simply screaming out to God in a fit of anger when somebody's driving you crazy or something is happening that you don't like and you just start screaming and hollering, "Give me patience! Give me patience!" You don't get it that way. You can raise your voice even more, but it's not going to come any quicker than by this path to patience. Number one, we see the challenge to be patient. It's a challenge. If it automatically occurred, then it wouldn't be a big deal. But it's a challenge for us to go from where we were in life. And as we see, it is, progressively speaking, the final step before you get to godly. I guarantee you, if we went around the room, we would have a lot of people, if we were asking them, they'd say, "Do you think you're relatively godly?" "Oh, yes. Yes, I'm very godly." How do you fare in the patience department? "Oh, boy, I need that." Well, according to Peter here, you've jumped over something. You've circumvented the patience portion and went to godly. No, there's a challenge. Luke 21 and verse 19, the Bible says, in your patience possess ye your souls. Paul said to Timothy in 1 Timothy 6 and verse 11, but thou, O man of God, flee these things and follow after righteousness, godliness, faith, love, patience, meekness. What I'm trying to say to us tonight, folks, is that patience isn't something that you can take or leave. Patience is something that is required in the Christian life. This name it, claim it business, God does not operate in that realm. I know some groups seem to think that that's how God works, but it's not. And part of our development in the Christian life is to learn to be patient. Titus 2 and verse 2, he said that the aged men be sober, grave, temperate, sound in faith, in charity, in patience. He's talking to old men. It's not something that only the young people have to learn. Be patient, be patient. Even old people have to learn to be patient. Hebrews 6 and verse 11 and 12, and we desire that every one of you should show the same diligence to the full assurance of hope and unto the end, that you be not slothful, but followers of them who through faith and patience inherit the promises. Through faith and patience. See, there is a real challenge. We think that we can, as I said earlier, we can take or leave the patience business when it is connected to godliness, when it's connected to faith, and we want to separate it and make it something else. I think, you know, we spend too much time on trying to make sure that Christians are not smoking. You know? Hey, I don't think it's a good, healthy practice, but I'll tell you what, I've met some people that probably had a lot more to offer in the Christian life, and they smoked. You know? And then I've met some folks that don't smoke and never smoked, but I wouldn't give you 2 cents for their spirituality. So, you know, we kind of make a big deal about sometimes the wrong things. And patience is one of those things that I think we need to learn, and we need to learn it well, and it is a challenge. I think we ought to be up for the challenge. James 5 and verse 7 said, be patient therefore, brethren, unto the coming of the Lord. So we're going to have to learn to be patient in all areas of our lives until Jesus comes. And we're going to have to be patient even as it relates to him coming. I remember Archie Bunker years ago had a real problem with Edith. She was going through the change, and it was bothering him tremendously, and to the point where I think he was losing his patience maybe. And he pointed at his watch and he said, Edith, I'm going to give you 30 seconds to change. Now change. Well, I think a lot of times we want the Lord to come back and we're saying, and I'm going to give you about another minute to come back. Or what? You know, Bible already says he's not going to tarry. So when it's his time to come, number one, we have the challenge to be patient. Number two, we have a condition for patience. There is a condition. It doesn't just happen. It doesn't float in from outer space. The Bible says in Luke 8 and verse 15, but that on the good ground are they which in an honest and good heart, having heard the word and keep it, and bring forth fruit with patience. So what does that tell me about the condition for patience? The condition is that you are going to have to begin and diligently work at it and continue at it day in and day out. You're going to have to take what the Word of God says and keep it and do it every day. Just, just do it? Is it? I don't know, that's one of them. Anyway, just do it. Well, guess what? The Bible says that. You know, in 1 Corinthians 9 and verse 24 and 25, he said, "Know ye not that they which run in a race run all, but one receiveth the prize." Huh. Whoa. Wait a minute. Lord, you need to change that. Imagine God saying that they run a race and only one person gets the prize? I think everyone should get a trophy. They all ran, didn't they? So run that you may obtain. And every man that striveth for the mastery is temperate in all things. Now they do it to obtain a corruptible crown, but we an incorruptible. What is it? They do it. Do what? Strive for the mastery. Again, the challenge to us is to work toward being patient. And so you'll have to do it. How do you do it? You be patient. You develop patience by being patient. Wow, that's deep. You want a minute to write that down? I mean, think about it. How many people have wanted to go to bed at night and slip this Bible under their pillow and wake up in the morning quoting verses? It doesn't happen that way. And you're not going to wake up tomorrow morning because you said a prayer tonight and said, "Lord, make me a patient person." It doesn't develop that way. You have to be patient. And as you develop that, you will, with time. It's like the people that say, you know, how do you know if you've walked the Christian life? You know, if you're leading a spiritual life. Well, how do you do it? You do it every day. You do it every day, and then somewhere down the road, a year from now, 10 years from now, you'll be able, if you've done it every day, you'll look back and you say, "You know what? I've been following the Lord for the last 10 years." But you can't say to God beforehand, "Make me follow you for 10 years. No, it doesn't happen that way. "Thy word is a lamp unto my feet and a light unto my path." And so God gives us just enough light to know where we're at and enough light to take the next step. And that's what we need to do as it relates to patience. Colossians 3 and verse 23 and 24 says, "And whatsoever ye do, do it heartily as unto the Lord." So, be patient. Tell God, "Lord, I'm waiting on you." He said, "Wait on the Lord, be of good courage, and he shall strengthen thine heart." And that seemed to be a good way to develop patience. So we have the challenge to be patient. We have the condition for patience. Number three, we have the cause for patience. In Romans 5 and verse 3 to 5, Paul writes, "And not only so, but we glory in tribulations." You ever read that? And you got that far and you say, "I don't." No, but notice what he says. "Knowing this, that tribulation worketh patience." No wonder we didn't want to read anymore. No wonder we immediately said, "I don't glory in tribulations." Of course not. And I'll guarantee you, if you don't, you're definitely not patient. He said, because tribulation worketh patience. And patience experience. And experience hope. And hope maketh not ashamed. It's progressive. Just like Peter spoke of here. We're to add to it. We're to build line upon line, precept upon precept, here a little, there a little. James 1 and verse 3 and 4, "Knowing this, that the trying of your faith worketh patience." It comes through trying and tribulation, and then it just develops. When you learn to do those things individually, He said again in James 1:4, but let patience have her perfect work. Because what does patience do? Well, according to James, patience work will leave you perfect and entire, wanting nothing, if you can be patient. Paul wrote in Romans chapter 5 that patience would give you experience. Peter recorded here, he said, patience, the next step after patience is godliness. You don't hear a whole lot preached on patience, other than that we ought to be patient. But when we take a good hard look at what patience involves and what it does for us, I think we ought to probably put a little more effort into trying to be patient. See, we want everything just like this. And we want that. We want people to be saved like that. I gave them a track. I don't know why they didn't get saved. I said a prayer. I prayed for them. I prayed for them yesterday. You mean they didn't get saved? Brother so-and-so, he's not living right. And I said a prayer for him. And you mean he didn't get right? We want everything to take place immediately. Now, I understand we live in the day and the age where just about everything can happen immediately. There are all these drive-up windows. You can pull up to any one of them and make your demand and collect right away. But life is not a drive-up window. James again says in James 5 and verse 10 and 11, take my brethren, the prophets, who have spoken in the name of the Lord for an example of suffering affliction and of patience. Oh, man. Notice how patience is always connected with something unpleasant. Well, yeah, that's how it's developed. Behold, we count them happy which endure. Then he says, you've heard of the patience of Job and have seen the end of the Lord, that the Lord is very pitiful and of tender mercy. So maybe it's not an overly inviting thought to think, well, you mean if I'm going to develop patience, I have to go through like what Job went through? Well, you don't have to necessarily go through what Job went through, but if you want the patience, if you want the Bible to record about the patience of Louis, then, because that's what he told me. He said, you've heard of the patience of Job. Well, Job's patience is recorded in the Word of God because of the trying of his faith. God notices. And then, number four, let me say, we see the comfort in patience. Romans 8 and verse 23 to 25. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. For we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what a man seeth, why doth he yet hope for? But if we hope for that which we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. We say things like, there's a better day coming. You know, heaven's right around the corner. See, we wait with patience. One of these days, folks. See, the reason why we can endure all of this is because we know what lies down the road. You know, in Hebrews chapter 12, the Bible, speaking of Jesus going to the cross, said that he endured the cross despising the shame. Well, why did he do that? The Bible says, for the joy that was set before him. That's how. He was able to, that's the comfort in patience, to know that, just wait a little. Just wait, hang in there, a little bit more. Jesus knew, even as he lugged his cross to Calvary, that he could see them wailing. And what did Jesus say to the women in Luke 23? He said, daughters of Jerusalem, he said, weep not for me, but weep for yourselves and your children. Why? Don't weep for me. Are you kidding me? Don't you realize in 3 days I'm going to be up alive and well again? Patience. Romans 15:4. For whatsoever things were written aforetime were written for our learning, that we through patience and comfort of the Scriptures might have hope. Just wait. Just wait on the Lord. Be of good courage. 2 Corinthians 6 and verse 4 and 5, but in all things approving ourselves as the ministers of God, in much patience, in afflictions, in the... Notice how... Watch this list. In much patience, in afflictions, in necessities, in distresses, in stripes, in imprisonments, in tumults, in labors, in watchings, in fastings. Is there anything good in that list? Well, yeah, the patience. Yeah, but the way that the patience is, in much patience, we're supposed to be able to handle all of those things. Remember how Paul said, I can do all things through Christ, which strengthens me. Number five, let me say we see the clout. Call it the clout of patience. In other words, the power that's behind it. Romans 15:5 says, now the God of patience. God uses that as a title for himself. The God of patience and consolation grant you to be like-minded one toward another according to Christ Jesus. Think of how patient God is with us. Can you imagine if God was as impatient as we are? He'd squash us like a bug. And yet we find ourselves totally impatient with one another. I can't believe they did that. Oh, they better apologize to me. Now, think about if God, the God of all patience, if he had that attitude towards us, what a mess we'd be in. Colossians 1:11 says, strengthened with all might according to his glorious power unto all patience and longsuffering with joyfulness. The cloud of patience. And then, let me give you the last one here. We see the cases of patience. Hebrews 12 in verse 1 and 2, wherefore seeing we also are compassed about with so great a cloud of witnesses, let us lay aside every weight and the sin which doth so easily beset us, and let us run with patience the race that is set before us, looking unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. Again, as I just quoted, for the joy that was set before him. What did he do? He endured the cross, despising the shame, and is set down at the right hand of the throne of God. 1 Thessalonians 1:3 says, remembering without ceasing your work of faith, labor of love, and patience of hope in our Lord Jesus Christ in the sight of God and our Father. Paul, writing to Timothy, said in 2 Timothy 3:10, but thou hast fully known. Do people know these things about us? Paul said, you know my doctrine, manner of life, purpose, faith, long-suffering, charity, patience. You know, as part of our makeup, somebody should be able to point at us and say, boy, they got some patience.
You've been watching the Voice of Victory telecast, an outreach ministry of Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church in Blackstone, Massachusetts. We are an independent, King James Bible-believing Baptist church. Our goal is to reach people with the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, our Lord. You are invited to attend any of our Bible-centered services. Our service times are as follows. Sunday school for all ages at 9:30 a.m. Sunday worship services at 10:30 a.m. and again at 6 p.m. And our midweek prayer meeting and Bible study Wednesday at 7 p.m. You may write to Solid Rock Bible Baptist Church at 214 Main Street, Blackstone, Massachusetts, or call us at area code 508.